and I have a copy of your baptism, or your, not baptism, but the dedication here. Or before you go, please get a copy of that. But God is moving here on this coast. God is moving in our church, and He's moving in our hearts. Amen. Our God is jealous for us. He wants us, and He wants us to have that close relationship with Him. And remember, a couple of weeks ago when we were at prayer on Sunday night, we were praying about the revival and about what God's doing. The guy from the Gideons had just been here that morning. And we were waiting for the guys that came last week, and we were saying, Lord God, whatever you want. And I had mentioned that night at prayer that I didn't think it's going to be necessarily a corporate thing to where everybody's going at the same time, but it's going to be an individual thing to where we individually get off ourselves and start going out there and doing the work of the ministry like it says we're supposed to do. Seems like I read that somewhere, raising up the people that they do the work of the ministry, right? And interestingly enough, the guys that came from Indiana said the same thing, that before anything corporate happens, it's got to start on an individual basis. And so that's what God is doing, is moving in our hearts individually. And then as that happens, as we get more and more excited about what God's doing, then it will be a corporate thing, and we will see the results of that. But it's got to start with individuals. We're the people that make up the church. This building isn't the church, right? The Lord God lives in our hearts. As long as we've received Him into our hearts, He has come and He dwells within us, and He wants that close, intimate relationship with us. He wants us to be able to come before Him open, not wondering, oh my goodness. See, for some reason, the enemy keeps trying to tell us that God's this big cosmic meanie that's just waiting to squash you like a bug, right? But that's not the case at all. God wants that close, intimate relationship with each and every one of us. I've been out of the pulpit for three weeks. With other people in here, and that's been great. I don't mind that at all. When God's moving, whatever God wants to do. But I had done a message about how the word that we speak every week, the 2 Chronicles 7:14, that my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. Seeking the face of God, having that close relationship with Him, and we know that when we do that, He says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then He'll hear from heaven. He'll forgive our sins and heal our land. I need my land to be healed. I don't know about you and your life, but my land, my life, the people around me that touch me and that I am close to need some healing. Amen? I need healing in my own life. So, Lord God, as we come before You, we say, Lord Jesus, we humble ourselves. I'm not all that in a bag of chips. I need Him now as much or more than I ever have. It's not like, oh, well, I got saved in 1976. I checked that off my list. I'm going about my business. No, I need Him now just as much as I ever have. And He is there for me. That's what's amazing. He's still there for me. He's still saying, come. Come unto me, all you're heavy laden, and I'll give you rest, right? Take my yoke upon you, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The enemy wants to keep telling us in our own stupid brain, our own wonderful brain, keeps telling us that it's a hard thing to follow after the Lord. That's the biggest lie that the enemy has ever spoken. And so easily it is taken into us and we receive that garbage as if it's true. It is not true. The Lord God says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. He comes to set us free, not to burden us down, to set us free from all the stuff that so easily comes upon us and just weighs us down. This world is a tough taskmaster. But God wants us to cry out, Abba, Father. He wants us to say, Lord God, I need you. And the word, the Abba, comes into the, is spoken three times in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, rather. And it's always followed by Father. Abba, Father. It's a warm and tender term that a little child would use for his father or her father. A warm and tender term. It's the closest we can come to is Daddy. Have you ever, now, unfortunately, some of us didn't have necessarily a great relationship with our earthly father. My father was an alcoholic that was unfortunately addicted to alcohol for all of his, well, all of the life that I knew him anyway. I was the youngest of six. And he drank every day of his life until he got so sick he couldn't get to the store to buy his liquor anymore. But I believe he came to the Lord before he went. But he was a good man. He wasn't a violent drunk or anything like that. He wasn't mean or anything like that. He was fun and joke around and everything, but I don't think I ever remember him hugging me. And that's a shame, but we always loved him. He was Daddy, you know. But sometimes we have to get over some of the things that our earthly father did to us to be able to relate to our heavenly father. Those of us that were blessed with good fathers that we can love on, it's easy to realize that our heavenly father loves us as well. That he wants us to climb up in his lap and say, Daddy, oh Lord. See, we can come, like I was saying a couple of weeks ago, that we can come and say, Lord, give me this. I need, give us this day our daily bread, right? We need food. We need a place to live and all that sort of stuff. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. We come and seek him. We come and crawl up in his lap. And as we come and have that close relationship with him, all this other stuff melts away. You know, many, many times I'll come before the Lord and start to pray about such and such. You know, oh Lord, my wife needs healing. He knows that, and he wants me to ask him for things like this. But all of a sudden, I'll start getting all these other things out of the way to where I can see him. And I come and say, oh Lord Jesus, let me climb up in your lap. Oh Father, thank you for loving me and sending your son for me, that I can seek his face, that I can love on him, I can sit in his lap. And it's not a scary thing because he is my daddy. It's a warm and tender relationship. It's not an adversarial relationship. It's the kind of thing where we say, yes, Lord. And as I confessed a couple of weeks ago, that sometimes we get so caught up in what's going on in this world around us, where, yes, I'm sick, my wife's sick, this is going on, that's going on, everything else is happening. And before you know it, I put this in front of me, between me and my God, and this and this and this. And all of a sudden you go, where are you at, Lord? Where are you at? Well, I've got all these things that's blocking my way, that I'm looking at all these different things around me, and I can't see him because I'm seeing all the other stuff around me. Amen? Does that happen to anyone else? Okay, I got one here that agrees. Praise God. But God wants us to seek my face. I need to see you, Lord. Not these things that are around me. I can't see all this stuff and still see you too. If I can see you, a lot of times I go and start praying and I see his face and I just fall on my face. And Lord God, thank you so much for loving me. Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Lord, for loving me and just worshiping him. And all the other things just kind of melt away. And I'll realize that I didn't even have time to pray for all the things that I thought was so necessary, right? God knows these things, and there's nothing wrong with praying for them. That's not a problem at all. Not saying don't do that. That's not an issue. But if we seek his face, if we seek his will, if we seek just to love him back and forth, we cry out, oh, Lord, oh, my Lord, thank you, Lord, for loving me. As I told you before, when I got saved and Jesus brought me to the Father, and the Father immediately just says, I'll take him. I just could not believe that God Almighty didn't even think about that for a second. He just said, I'll take him. I went, wow, how can you do that? But that's how much he loves us. That's how much he loves us. And I told you, I was not a good guy when that happened. I had every drug known to man in the other room that I was selling to anyone that would buy it. And he just went, I'll take it. Wow, man. That is the spirit that causes us to cry out, Abba, Father. Amen. We see where Jesus did this. And where is he? He is in the Garden of Gethsemane. He's in the Garden of Gethsemane in Mark chapter 14. And he's going and he's sweating profusely and crying out and saying, oh Lord. He says, Abba, Father, Daddy, Father. All things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. Here he is in the midst of the biggest trial anyone could possibly go through. Because he knew that he was about to take the sins of the world on himself. And not only that, he would be cut off from his Father for a few minutes. Until he got out of that body. But remember, he cried out on the cross, why have you forsaken me, because of all the sins that come upon him. And he realized he couldn't see his Father anymore for a minute. Remember how Jesus would always go off and pray, right? Constantly going off to pray. And in the midst of everything, he would say, well, I just got to go off and pray. You guys go across the way. Remember? You guys go on across the Sea of Galilee, and I'll be over there in a little bit. And they took the boat and headed out, and he went off to pray. And they had been out there for a number of hours. He had been up on the mountain praying to God Almighty. He wanted to see his Father's face. Remember, Jesus says, I can do nothing of my own except what I see my Father in heaven doing. Lord, show me what you're doing. Show me what you're doing so I can get on your page rather than, Lord, I want to go over here and heal this guy and I want to preach to these people. No. Lord, I want to see you. I want to see what you're doing. I want you to anoint my hands at your will, Lord God. Show me that I might follow whatever you want me to do. And of course, I pray that here today, Lord. Show me that I may see what you're doing and minister to your people. And I know he's going to do that here today. He's already showing me things like that. But he comes and he cries out in the midst of the greatest tribulation anyone could ever have. That he knows that he's about to take on everything and be beaten. I imagine his flesh didn't look forward to getting beaten in the face and his beard ripped out and the lashes on his back and everything else. I can imagine he was getting very antsy, but he cried out, oh, Daddy, I don't care about all this stuff. Lord God, I want to see you. Lord, take this away, but not what I want. It isn't about me. See, he put himself to the side. I need to see you, Father, your will. I know that God's will is always perfect. Even in the midst of the craziest thing going on, your will be done. I always say, you know, we always want to do it. Lord, do it this way. And at this time, at 10:32 in the morning, I want to be able to pray for so-and-so and see him heal, Lord God. No, Lord God, I want to cry out in Jesus' holy name to you. Crazy thing. But in Romans 8:15 it says, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. There we go. We didn't receive the spirit of bondage again. We are in bondage, and sometimes my heart cries out for God's people when they're in bondage to things. We get so wound up in the things that's in this earth, amen? We get so wound up and so heavy laden. Come unto me, are you heavy laden? Right? We get so bound up in all these things, and all of a sudden we can't see anything. But he didn't give us that spirit of bondage, again, to fear. Fear is a rough taskmaster, right? Fear is something horrible that will just eat you up and eat you away, and it won't relent. But he did not give us that spirit of fear, but you receive the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. We've been adopted by Him to where we can cry out, Daddy. I'm not just some stranger just walked into the house and say, hey, can I speak to the man of the house or the main guy here? No. So I looked up the word adoption. It's derived from two words. Son, one word is son, and the word, other word is placement. He has placed us into His family. It's not just as we think of adoption any longer, but He has placed us into His family and as His sons and His daughters. So He did it, right? It's not like we said, oh, I think I'll give God a try. We've heard so many different people. Politicians are great at this, but so are anyone else as well. That I think I'll choose Christianity as my religion. I've heard a very high up official in our government not within the last couple of years saying, I chose Christianity to be my religion. That I turned my back on Muslim and all this sort of other stuff, and I chose Christianity to be my religion. Well, you can do that as a religion, but He wants a relationship instead, right?
Amen.
He wants us to be adopted, that we come and say, Lord God, wash me and cleanse me and take me into Your family. And He says, yes. He adopts us. But see, by giving us His Son, the Spirit of His Son, we have in effect become His natural born children. Not just adopted, but begotten. The way these words are defined in the Greek, it gives that connotation to it. That we're not just adopted like we see it, but He actually grafts us right into the family to where now it's like as if we are His own blood children. That's how close God has wanting that relationship with us, that close tie. I know you mothers can certainly relate to your own children. There's a certain bond when you have carried that child in your womb, and now here they are, even grown, and you've got that thing that's just holds on to you like there's nothing else on this earth that is that same bond. And fathers, yes, we do have the same bond, but it's a different thing for a mother. It really is, as if I can tell, right? But I know from what I can, what I've observed, though. But us fathers, as well, reach out to our children. We know that that's our children. It's interesting that the father determines the blood type, the blood that courses through the veins of us, right? And how God the Father, through the Holy Spirit, impregnated Mary, and she carried out the blood of God Almighty in His veins. And that's how His blood cleansed us. It wasn't the blood that we have, but it was His blood that He gave, right? But He changes us to basically become His natural born children, not just adopted as we understand it. In Galatians 4:5, He says, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. He redeemed us from the law. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Oh, Lord, Daddy, come and be my God, Lord God. I lay myself down. I put everything at Your feet, Lord God. I don't want anything else there between me and You. And He goes on to say, therefore, you are no longer a slave. I was a slave to sin. I was a slave to my own wants and desires. But I'm no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, I'm an heir of God through Christ.
Amen.
An heir. I get the same privileges as Jesus does at the throne. I can walk right into His throne room. Walk into the Holy of Holies. Remember the book of Esther? Esther, after she had become queen, she went before the king. She wasn't invited. Back then in that culture, the king had to request your presence and you had to come. That's why Queen Vashti was thrown out because he said, you come, she didn't come. makes me kind of wonder if that's sort of like a type and shadow of the Lord Jesus calling the church, calling us. Remember the 10 virgins, right? 5 of them were wise. They were all ready, and he said, come. And they said, let's go, boy. 5 of them were not. And when he said, come, they said, no, we don't have our stuff together. I don't have my stuff together. I can't come. And it's almost like Queen Vashti. When he said, come, it doesn't say why she didn't come. It just says, she says, nah, I ain't going to come. I got other things doing here. I'm entertaining my own friends, right? She had a party for her own people. The king was having his party, and she was having her own party with her girlfriends. And she said, no, I'm not going to go. Doesn't say why. Doesn't say whether or not she's going, well, that guy's drunk, and he just wants to parade me before everybody. I'm not going to do it. But whatever the reason was, she refused to go. And we need to be ready, just as Jesus called us, that we can come whenever it is, but we have that right. But later on in the book of Esther, she walked in to the king's inner chamber, into the inner courts, is what it says in many translations. Anyway, went into the inner courts where the king was without being invited. And he looked and saw her, and the love said, yes, come on in. Doesn't that sound like our Father in heaven, right? I mean, God Almighty has got so many things running through His Scripture, through the Word of God. These are real stories of what happened. These are things that really took place. But they give us lessons over and over and over again to where He had her heart. She had His heart. And as soon as He saw her, He went, yes, come on in. Come over here. I want to hug you and hold you and be a part of you. You can walk right in to the very throne room of God, because we are not a slave any longer. We're not a slave to sin. We're not a slave to our wants, own wants and desires, but we're a son or a daughter of Him. He says that if we're a son, then we're an heir. We have all the same privileges of God that He does. 2 Corinthians 6:18 says, I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. I'll be a father to you. Boy, what a father to have, amen? Oh my goodness. Amen. Lord God, of all the fathers, if your father didn't treat you all that great, you've got a father that treats you amazingly well. He says, Jesus says that, let's see, how did he put it? Don't worry about the things we're constantly concerning ourselves about the different things. Matter of fact, it's in Matthew chapter 6. He says, don't worry about all the things. Where are you going to live? What are you going to eat? What are you going to wear? He says, the pagans think about those things or worry about those things. Don't worry about that. Your Father in heaven knows you need those things before you even ask. He knows all that stuff. Lord God, what's our part? Seek ye first. What's his part? All these other things. All this stuff down here that we need. I need water, you know. I need food. He knows that. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. But he says, I will be a father to you. He made the decision on his end. The word says that there's none righteous, no, not none, no, not any. No one seeks the Lord, no one seeks him, but God seeks us out. I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters. I want that close, intimate relationship with you, because he first loved us. Many times, or well, actually 9 times in the Scriptures, in the New Testament, he calls us his little children, my little children. What an amazing thing that God Almighty just calls us out and says, my little children, I'm doing these things so that you will know my joy, that my joy will be complete in you. In 1 John, he goes through it several times. Most of the times are in 1 John. Actually, also I think it's in Galatians he uses that same term, my little children, that he loves so much. He tells us in 1 John, we give you all these things so that your joy may be complete. My little children, I'm looking out for you. My little children, in First John chapter 2, verse 1, he says, my little children, I write these to you that none of you sin. But if you do sin, we've got an advocate with the Father. Isn't that amazing that God is looking out for us? He knows that we're going to mess up, but it's okay. All my little children, I want to hold you close to me. It's okay. I know you're just like the little one that was here a minute ago. But she is so completely reliant upon her parents, her father and her mother. And that she got hungry here a minute ago, it sounded like. And she says, I need something to eat. And Mom went, I got what you need here. I'll go and take care of you. That's what the mother and the father does, right? They take care of their little ones. Oh, my little ones. Come and let me hold you. Come and let us have that close relationship. 9 different times. That's interesting that he is so ready, reaching out to us. Amen? 1 Corinthians 1:9 says, God is faithful. He doesn't forget to do these things, right? He's faithful. He's always looking out for our best interests. He is always there for us. By whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. He's faithful. He wants us there. He wants us as his own. He wants that close relationship. Of all things, he died so that he could have us close to him, that we might have that fellowship with him. 1 John 1:3, here we go. That which we have seen and heard and declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Here's John, which I always say is Jesus' best bud, right? They were close friends when he was here on this earth. And he's saying, I've seen him. I've heard his voice physically. I've touched him. I've held on to him. And so I'm declaring that to you so that you may have the fellowship with us. Fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father. I get to have fellowship with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. I get that close fellowship with him. So what in the world does fellowship mean? The Greek word is koinonia. You ever heard the word koinonia before? A number of times back in the 70s or so, a lot of churches would call their home groups and things like that koinonia, where they would have that fellowship. And it means partnership. We're partnered up. And so we're partnered not only with one another, we have fellowship with one another, but we have fellowship with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. We have that partnership. If I'm ever going to have a partnership with anyone, I want it to be with the Lord, right? What a partnership. He's considering me his partner. Isn't that amazing?
Yes.
He considers me his partner. We're in this together. And participation, we participate. He participates in our lives. Sometimes we forget and say, oh, Lord, where are you? I don't know where you are, Lord God. He's participating. He's right there. Even when things aren't going the way we think it should go, he is there. He is participating in exactly what we're going through. He knows it in intimate detail much better than we do. Even when things don't go the way we want them to. Even when things don't go the way that make any sense to us. We're going, Lord, what happened? He's still there. He's still our partner. He's still our participation. One, he's still participating with us to communicate. We can communicate with our Lord God. We can come into his presence and say, yes, Lord, wash me and cleanse me. We can talk with him and carry on a conversation with him all through the Word of God. From Genesis, where we see God walking through the garden and talking in the cool of the evening with Adam and Eve, to where we see Abraham, where he was talking with him left and right all the time, constantly having conversations with his people. Constantly talking with Moses. He called it, said, Moses is a friend and we speak face to face. Praise God. All the way through. Joshua, you name it, all the way through. David and God Almighty speaking, having a conversation and communication and communion with his people. And then, of course, he wanted it even closer, so Jesus came to this earth. And we see through the Gospels where he came and had that relationship with as many as would receive him.
the 70, the 120, then the 70 got closer and all the way down to the 12 where he really had that close and tight relationship with. See, some people the same way in the church. Some people want that really intimate relationship. And some people are kind of on the perimeter, right? They only come into the outer courts. Remember in the when they made the temple in the wilderness? You had the outer court, then inner court, and then the Holy of Holies. It seems like we have the same thing going on in our churches and sometimes in our hearts. Some of us want to have that close and intimate relationship. God wants that with all of us. The doors are open. The doors were never locked. As a matter of fact, in the camp in the wilderness, there was no door on the outer court or anything. It was just an open gate. You would just walk around a little partition and go right in. And the first thing there was the altar of sacrifice. You had to lay your sacrifice on the altar first. We sacrifice ourselves, Lord God, wash me and cleanse me. Here's my blood. Let me spill, Lord God, everything I want, my wants and my desires. I sacrifice it all for you to make you my Lord, right? But God wants us to be able to come just like Queen Esther, to come right into the Holy of Holies. He wants us. It's open. He said, we are priests now, right? The priests were the only one that could come into the Holy of Holies, right? Now, Jesus says that rent, that curtain was rent from top to bottom to where now all can enter. We are called his priests. He wants that koinonia, that relationship with us, that communion, that communication with us, that participation, that partnership. Revelation 3:20, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me. First time I heard this, the word of God was spoken to me by the Lord himself. I'd never heard this. I was a good Catholic. We didn't study the Bible or anything like that. And when Jesus was coming into me, when I laid my head on his chest in the vision that I had, and I went to squeeze him and my head went into his chest, and I backed up and went, what in the world's going on? And this scripture came. No one's lips moved or anything, but this scripture came. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens the door, here's my voice, opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him. He says, I want to come into you. I want to have that close of a relationship with you. There's another word that I didn't put up here on fellowship, on koinonia. It means a very close, and that's why he's saying, I stand at the door and knock. I want to come into you. I want to have that close and personal relationship with you, and it is a word that we use for a relationship between a husband and wife, a very intimate relationship, a very close relationship. It's amazing how the Lord God Almighty wants us for his own. He wants that close one-on-one relationship to where we seek his face. We seek his face. And at that point, all the things that we're so worried about and concerned, when we can see him for who he is, all this stuff falls away. It just melts. And you say, I know God's got this. I don't have to worry about this. I can just say, yes, Lord. As long as I can see you, everything else is okay. Because I see who he is. I see the Lord God Almighty, the King of the universe, the Prince of Peace. Give me that peace. How can you be worried when you have the Prince of Peace living inside of you? But see, our flesh wants to rise up all the time and say, oh man, and we can certainly get worried about different things, especially when you're in the midst of everything. But the Lord God wants to have that close and intimate relationship where we can say, oh Lord, as long as I can see you, everything else is okay. The heart of God to me is wrapped up in this verse right here, where Jesus is coming into Jerusalem, riding on the donkey, right? And he gets to the place where he can overlook and see Jerusalem, and he says, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. I wanted to hold you. I wanted to cuddle you, to bring you up close to me, safe and secure, but you wouldn't do it. It's killing. It's broken in his heart. He has a broken heart here. Jesus is saying, I wanted that close and intimate relationship with you, but you wouldn't do it. Let me in, please. He's standing at the door and knocking and saying, I want to come in there. Because what I've got is peace. I've got joy. I've got victory. But this right here just shows his heart. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, I send the prophets to you and you kill them. I don't want to hear the word of God that they're saying. And it just breaks his heart. I want that close relationship with you. As a matter of fact, the Jewish rabbis would say of a Gentile convert that they've come under the wings of the Shekinah glory of God. That we have come under the wings of the Shekinah glory of God. I know Brother Bill tells a story of, I think it was you, that, about how there was a wildfire on the prairie. And the guy was going up through his fields and looking and assessing the damage. And he saw this one little clump sitting there in the middle of everywhere that was burned. And he's wondering what this little clump of something was. And he walked over and kicked it. And all these little chicks ran out from underneath. And it was a mother hen that had done just what Jesus had said. Held that, those chicks under her wings to protect them from that wildfire as it went. And they were all safe. Mm-hmm. She gave up her life for those chicks. And he gave up his life to protect us. He wants us under those wings, under those coverings, that he can protect us. He wants that close, close relationship with us. Our God loves us, and he wants to have us as his own. The Lord God's been moving. He's been very good over the last few weeks, hasn't it? The Lord is moving. He wants us as his own. He is showing himself that he wants to have a revival, but it's got to start with us, in our hearts. It's not something that we can say, oh Lord, let the church come together and let's do this and that. We're the church. We're the ones. Lord, start with me. I need a revival, and I need to get everything else out of the way to where I can see you. If I can see his face, even if he slay me, yet I will trust him. I will still serve him. Praise God. I need to see you, Lord. That's what he's calling out. That's the beginning of any kind of a revival. And I believe that God is honoring us that have been praying for all these months. I don't remember how long we've been doing it. It's been almost a year now, I guess, close to it, that we've been praying on Sunday nights. And God is honoring that. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, we've been humbling ourselves and praying. We've been seeking his face. We've been turning from our wicked ways, and he is honoring us. I know Devin is going to be okay. I know he is. I know he is. I know one thing. I know that he has known the Lord, or known of the Lord, and the Lord God is reaching out to him. And he didn't want to talk the other day when I went in there, but I just sat there, hung out for a little while, and pretty quick the Lord opened the door. And he believes that he got hurt by the church. He didn't get hurt by the church. He got hurt by people in the church.
That's right.
He got hurt by people in the church, and it happens so often, unfortunately. When I will not have that, I will not have that in our church anymore. That is a killer. It will kill the church. It will kill your relationship. So many people left this church and every other church, because someone else said something or did something wrong. Happens over and over and over again. Over and over and over again. Sometimes, some way, someone's got to stop and say, enough of this. I'm not going to allow this to happen, because if you leave, you're going to change scenery, is all you're going to do. Because sooner or later, someone there, see, we got all these beings in these places, human beings. Not red beans or anything like that, but human beings. And pretty quick, some human being's going to say something stupid to you, do something stupid to you. All you're going to do is change your scenery for a little bit. Don't allow that. Our God is our God, and He wants to have that close relationship with us, but He also wants us to have that same fellowship with one another. Amen. That close relationship.